She was a pop sensation like no other. Her music inspired the country and defined a generation. But her fall from the spotlight was as quick as it was painful. An unspeakable addiction would lead to a near-fatal car crash and the loss of her fortune. In an effort to revive her career, she would return to the studio and produce perhaps the worst record of anyone's career ever. She would drop out of society and move to India, devoting all of her time to charity in hopes of finding her inner spirit, only to find herself thrust back into the spotlight with a record-breaking comeback special that would secure her place in music history. Who the hell is Melissa Lefton? And Behind the Muse continues. Welcome to Behind the Muse, the untold stories that never happened to the people you haven't heard of yet. Melissa Peggy Sue William House Gregory Lefton was born to a simple life in rural Indiana. But the beautiful surroundings would not impress the young girl. Even as a small child, she knew she was destined for something better than animal husbandry.
Growing up in rural Indiana doesn't do much for one's self-confidence. Everybody pretty much figured I was gonna grow up to milk cows. You know, that was it for me. But I proved them wrong. I knew that even though everyone around me was a piece of shit, I wasn't.
By the tender age of 7, she would demonstrate a lust for the spotlight that would plague her for the rest of her life.
I am only a knight. I ask beautiful sister.
By the time Melissa was in high school, the bug to be a star had molted into scabies, and she quickly hooked in with a local band in hopes of attracting some attention.
I decided that if I got a band together in high school, if I got a band together and we could just like rock the whole community, like with our awesome, just rebellious tunes, that we'd be pretty set.
We formed this band called Piss.
Everybody had like a different way of looking at things, and so I was just kind of like, look, you guys, can't we just work something out between all 5 of us? Like, can't we just have a song that we all agree on?
What are you doing? Get out!
Hey, Melissa, Melissa!
Fuck this! I am through with you! My career is not gonna go down the toilet because of you!
Hey, come on back!
Unfulfilled by the punk scene in Indiana, Melissa embarked on a journey that would lead down an alley, that would take her to a road, that would show her the path, that would enter a highway, that would lead to a tunnel, that would cost her $6.
Anyway, I got to New York. Eventually, I started to get these gigs, like at the coffee house. I was singing, like, I was really hurting at the time, so I was singing stuff about, like, guys who left me, and I was just like in pain, and I was strumming away, and that was, like, pretty cool, but, like, I don't know, I got really tired of making $20 a night, like, just trying to make ends meet.
Even though the raw passion in Melissa's music was not met with great enthusiasm in the pretentious coffee houses of New York, Melissa's hunger for success only grew stronger. She decided to take matters into her own hands and literally break into the music business.
Got a nice office here.
At some point, I was like, this is really hard, I'm really tired, and I'm gonna, like, it's gotta be easy to get a record deal. Like, people do it all the time. I'm just gonna f***ing go for it. I snuck into the record company, which is like totally crazy, I know, but it worked. Like, no one knew who I was. And I seduced like the president of the company. I was like, doesn't this feel good in your groin area? Like, I was like doing like a dance around him. So he's like, well, I'm gonna have to give you a record deal.
Jive Records immediately signed Melissa to a huge record deal, and the young star and her credit limit were rocketing skyward. With a hit song and a sold-out world tour, Melissa Lefton, the small-time girl from Indiana, seemed like she finally achieved her dream. seemed that living the life of a pop star was taking its toll on Melissa's mind.
So now I'm touring. Woo! I'm touring, and it's like, I'm going to do TRL next week. Woo! And I'm like,
at first, it seemed that Melissa was just a little nervous, like, common with such sudden fame.
To all my friends back in rural Indiana, fuck you, because I'm totally making it. I tend to think I'm really great. I'm going to be, like, bigger than Oreos.
Like, I have some friends in, like, the bathroom, whatever, they need me, so you guys done? Because, like, this is really cool and everything, but I need to go.
Little would anyone know, including Melissa, that this would be her first and only television interview for 10 years.
Hey, Melissa.
In this exclusive amateur video taken just hours before the biggest show of her career, in the basement of New York's world-famous Madison Square Garden, Melissa's dance with death would soon be exposed.
What are you doing? What are you doing? No! Put that down! What are you doing? Oh my... Holy shit! What are you doing? Oh my god! We have a... Holy shit! Oh my god! Hey, Sandy!
We don't need to go any shows.
We have a huge... I can't believe this! Hey, guys! Guys! She's all f***ed up!
Melissa's performance was canceled that evening, and her whereabouts were unknown for several days. Rumors started flying that she was kidnapped by drug dealers and forced to make knockoffs of Gucci handbags. But unfortunately for Melissa, the truth was much worse.
The moment I shot myself up with Senate was the moment I departed. And I said to myself, this is the way that I want to feel for the rest of my life. So,
as her Sunny D addiction grew, so did her desperation for money. She called upon the only person she thought she could trust, her friend and longtime manager, Shlomo Paisanowicz. But he would deliver a devastating blow that would push Melissa further over the edge.
But he says to me, you're screwed. You get nothing now. I'm the manager and I get all the money. You're just a shit face. You're just a Sunny D whore.
With the money gone and no hope in sight, Melissa, desperate to feed her addiction, took to the streets.
I make love to sweaty bums. Just to score ahead of Sunny D. It didn't feel good on my vagina.
Melissa makes one last desperate call to her psychic. But when her credit card was declined, she was once again left with nothing.
I hang up that phone, and I get into my Honda Civic, and I speed down the raceway, because I gotta score, because I gotta ease the pain. Suddenly, it's mayhem. I've got shards of glass in my face, twisting metal everywhere. And I can't find my knees.
The police report on Melissa's near-fatal crash listed the cause of the accident as an obvious plot point in a documentary film about a pop star. Although the initial lab reports couldn't determine what Sunny D was made of, the drug was considered non-narcotic and perfectly legal. Luckily, she was confined to a body cast for 6 months, forcing her to kick that monkey on her back.
Thank you, God, I said. And to this day, my relationship with God is tremendous.
She rededicated herself to her music and immediately went back to the studio.
Ouch! 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 I created a concept album called Ouch, which was really the direct expression of how I was feeling at the time. I was in a lot of pain. I mean, my knees hurt and my face hurt and my... ouch.
Hi, Melissa, that's it. Let's go to lunch. Okay, everybody, let's go.
Okay. Help me.
Melissa was in for yet another blow when the album was trashed by both critics and fans, claiming it sucked, once again, leaving Melissa alone and without a clue.
So after the commercial failure of Ouch, I really felt betrayed by my fans because they couldn't understand who I was and what I was feeling, and they didn't seem to have any sympathy for me, really. And I felt abandoned and lost. And so I took a trip to India.
Children now, don't delay the dawning of a brand new day in sunny.
After having relinquished my material possessions in search of our essential oneness, I went back to my humble shack in Madras, India. And the phone rings. And it's Las Vegas Caesar's Palace Lifetime Special. And they've called upon me to come back and sing for them. And they've offered me quite a large sum of greenbacks.
Once again, Melissa Lefton, the small-time girl from Indiana with a dream, turned middle age and found herself thrust back into the spotlight after a decade of doing nothing.
And so I left that miserable hellhole filled with smelly, disgusting skeletons, putrid children, for this.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's put our hands together as we welcome back. After a lifetime of sin and torment, yes, she's back from obscurity. Let's hear it from Melissa Lefton.
Record-breaking comeback special and newfound spirituality, Melissa has finally made it. Melissa Lefton's story is a nightmare in the dream of rising to fame. She certainly has secured a place in music history. Who the hell is Melissa Lefton?
Melissa Lefton was born in Chicago and began to play music when she was 10. She used to be in a band called Product, who made a record, but it was never released. Her songwriting ability was obvious, and she was soon signed to Jive. Funny, smart, and sexy, her music is all self-penned. It kicks ass and it'll make you laugh. Her debut album is coming soon. Stay tuned as the Melissa Lefton story continues to unfold.
Would you give me the Diet Coke in a little bottle? Yeah, with no ice. Thank you. Are we over? Is this over? This is bullshit. That's not on, right?
I am open to interpretation. Oh, the complexities of me. Open to interpretation. There is no... Don't box me in. I like to sing about cynical things. Things that are a bit inappropriate or taboo to sing about. I like to sing about things that pop songs aren't normally written about. Like sugar daddies, and I wrote a pop song about cancer once, which was kind of odd, but it was kind of good. I like to write songs about just about anything except for love. There's something very insidious and great about people just being like, woo! And it's, the chorus is just about cancer, you know? It's just a little insidious, it's a little weird, which I like. I like to make fun of everything because then I'm not held accountable for any real vulnerability or any real emotions. So I can just sort of stand a bit back from everything and just point the finger. It's much easier that way and more fun. So Hit Song was a very heartfelt anthem. I think we can all relate to a degree. You know, I'm breaking free from the confines of, you know, a society that oppresses me. It's a pop-oriented album. Sonically, very sweet and happy and hopeful, but lyrically, a bit more defeatist. Yes, it's a bit darker lyrically, but it's a bit more hopeful sonically. Well, Radio Rainbow is just about an acid trip where you're at a party and you're like the dork of the party and you show up in your party dress with a sash and you don't really know anybody and nobody talks to you, but then you have some punch and then you go on an acid trip. It's kind of like a free associated narrative. Pop Music's for Kids, Punk Rock Fever, is about the pivotal point in your adolescence where you go from being very, okay, let me try that again. So, Punk Rock Fever is about the point in time where you realize that, you know, the whole world sucks and everybody's stupid, and that you know better. And that happens generally around, I don't know, 15, 16, when you, you know, fold up and pack away the slacks and the button-downs, and you bring out the, you know, tight black jeans, and you get the mohawk, and you shave the sides of your hair, and you decide that you are going to be the one that teaches the world a lesson, because you're hip to new information that, you know, the whole world sucks. So you're going to be a shepherd. I love my record. My record, you know, I have trouble self-endorsing, but really, in my most desperate attempt to be genuine and earnest, I think it's a good record. I think that it has substance. And I think that it's catchy.
And well produced.
And very well produced, thanks to The Matrix. Very well produced. I like the whole Japanese aesthetic. It's very toy store and bright colors. And so I think the music sort of fits that aesthetic. Bright colors and plastic toys and games. I'm fading. Melissa, where is she? Plastic toys.